Thank you. It means a lot to me that you guys came out tonight. And I'm going to do one more for you. And it's another coming-of-age song, just a couple years later. And thank you for just kind of riding the roller coaster with me of tonight, you know. And when you're a songwriter and you open yourself up to writing about all kinds of things, you write some weird songs. So thanks for just joining the journey here. And thanks also for letting me sing that song about the Bible a few songs ago, you know. I mean, I have this job. Yeah, thank you. Well, I have this job, and I know that in this job, no audience member ever wants you to talk about the Bible, ever. Even religious people are like, not tonight, bro. We came out for some fun, you know. I don't care, though, man. I could talk about the Bible forever. I went to Catholic school for 12 years. I don't know if you guys have Catholic school up here. We had that down in Los Angeles, you know. And they're really into the Bible. That's like their favorite book. I don't know if you knew that. And they like that book a lot, and they're really into this guy Jesus. He's like the main character. He's like all over. He's like in half the Bible or something. He's really in it. And every day we would talk, and they would tell us stories about Jesus, and a lot of them made sense, you know, from like a religious standpoint. He was always doing good religious stuff, like healing blind people, you know, and making food out of nothing and stuff like that. But there was always one miracle that stood out to me that kind of, I always thought was strange, you know. It just kind of went against the teachings that they were normally giving us. They're always like, all right, don't smoke, don't drink, don't do drugs. But one time Jesus was at this wedding and they ran out of alcohol and they were like, oh no. And they were like, we're definitely going to need more alcohol if this party's going to keep going. And they were real stressed about it. So they went over to Jesus and they were like, Jesus, we're out of alcohol. And he was like, oh no, we got to get more. And they were like, can you help us? And Jesus was like, yeah, I can help you. Bring me some water. And so Jesus took the water and turned it into wine. And everyone got trashed. And it was a great party. Okay, next miracle. And I was like, oh, that's a little different. Okay. As a kid, though, that intrigued me. Because that seemed pretty groovy, you know. And so I would raise my hand. I remember I would be like, teacher, how often did he bust that one out, you know? Because you don't hear that one very often in his repertoire. And the teacher, you know, first time the teacher told me, she said, John, just that once, according to the Bible. And that was hard for me. That's when my faith first got questioned, you know. Because, like, I know how it is. I have this job, and I'll travel to a town, and people want to hear songs, you know. And that's just a song. That's not magic alcohol, you know. Like, I figured if Jesus really did pull that one off, that had to haunt his whole career, you know. That had to, like, become his free bird or something, you know. Like, everywhere he went, you know, he'd be, like, trying to give his Sermon on the Mount, you know, and he'd be like, love your neighbor as yourself. And some guy in the back is like, do water into wine. Jesus is like, yeah, I'll get there. Come on. Wait, just wait, guys. Poor Jesus, you know, trying out new stuff, you know. Be like, I got this new thing. Lazarus is dead. I'm going to raise him from the dead. They're like, no new stuff, just the classics, water and wine. Let's go. Poor Jesus, man. I know how it is, though. People don't want to talk about religious stuff. And I get in that mood sometimes, you know. About a year ago, I was on tour. It was the morning time, and I wasn't feeling very good. You know, I was just kind of down, and I was in a very sad part of town. And one thing I know about my generation's definition of sad part of town is different than the older generation's definition of sad part of town. Their definition would be like it's run down, you know, and there's a lot of poverty. My generation's definition is like if there's like a Starbucks and a Chipotle and it's just a strip mall, then we're like, that's a sad part of town. You know? So I was in the sad part of town. I was just sitting there, you know. And this guy walked up to me, and he looked at me. He was like, he was an older guy. He was like, hey, kid, you look bad. I was like, thank you. I appreciate that. Thanks for that. He sat down next to me, though, and he was like, I'd like to share a story with you. And I said, you know what? I'm not really in the mood for anything religious right now. I'm sorry. He said, no, don't worry. It's not religious. Just a story. I said, all right. What do you got? He said, John, a long time ago, there was a man who used to go down to the water to fetch water for his family. And I was like, this sounds hella religious, bro. He said, no, I swear it's not. I said, okay, continue. So he said, John, he would carry two buckets with him. And he said, the bucket in his left hand was a great bucket, very sturdy, a nice top-of-the-line bucket. But the bucket in his right hand was old, you know, it had cracks and had holes and stuff. He'd go down to the river, he'd fill up the buckets, he'd walk back up the hill to his house. But as he walked, you know, the left bucket would keep all the water in it, but the right bucket would splash and leak. And by the time he got to his little well, the right bucket would have barely any water in it. So one day he's emptying out his buckets, and the right bucket looks up at him and says, I was like, wait, the buckets are talking now? He said, yeah, the buckets are talking. I said, okay. So the right bucket says, he's like, man, you gotta let me go. Like, I'm a terrible bucket. I won't be offended. You know, lefty's doing great. I do nothing for you. Just, it's time for me to retire. And the old man, he turned to the bucket. He said, I want you to look down that path. And so the right bucket looked down the path, and he saw that on the left side of the path where the lefty would hang, you know, it was a normal path. But on the side where he would hang, there's all these flowers and vegetables growing, you know, and stuff. And he's like, what's going on, you know? And the old man said, well, I'm aware of your leaks, you know, so I plant seeds on that side of the path. And every day you water those seeds, and you have fed my family on your cracks, you know, and you've given my wife flowers on your holes, you know. And the bucket was happy. And the old man looked at me. He said, you see what I'm saying? I said, yeah, that's a good story. I said, but how is that not religious? That's not from the Bible or the Tao Te Ching or from Buddha. He said, no. I said, where'd you get it from? He said, I read it off a Chipotle bag. And I was like, hell no, I'm not taking advice from a Chipotle bag. He said, John, it doesn't matter where it's from. What matters is the message, you know. He said, the message is important. He said, the message is don't let anyone ever tell you to stop being sad, you know. That's your trip. Take your time. That's your journey. But don't wait till the sadness is gone to start living your life, you know. Get up. Get out there, you know. Cracks and all. Be broken. Let the water pour out. You never know who you're gonna feed. It's been an honor to sing to you tonight. Thank you so much for coming.